أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتحدون الذي لا يدركه بعد الحمم ولا يناله غوص الفطن ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا والشفيع ذنوبنا سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد ما صل على وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما بقية الله في الأرضين صاحب العصر والزمان خليفة الرحمن إمام الإنس والجان ولعن الله وعداهم أجمعين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله وقوله الحق. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا وإن الله لمع المحسنين. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. We are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this continued tawfiq to commemorate the shahadat and the days of grief of the Ahlul Bayt. Fatimiya is upon us, and many of the ulama have said that these days are no less than the days of Ashura. In fact, one can argue that the seed that was planted for the days of Ashura are in the days of Fatimiya. But if Fatimiya didn't exist, then the day of Ashura would not have existed either. So I am also thankful to the Awaited One Foundation and the other groups that are associated, and all of you, my beloved brothers and sisters here in Dearborn and in Michigan, for allowing this haqir and faqir to spend these beautiful days with all of you. We are here for 3 nights. We do have a topic in mind, as usual, and we'll get to that in a moment. I just wanted to mention a couple of things in the intro of these days. Some concerns I have, that when Fatimiya comes about every single year, it tends to create some emotions that can lead to a dangerous path. And with the era of social media, we have to be very, very careful. You see, Fatimiya usually triggers a lot of grief for us. We think about, of course, what happened to our mother. We have visual images like this door, for example, to my left. We hear about the details of how she left this world. And while we grieve her death, we also have a little bit of hatred and animosity and tension towards those who are responsible for that death. It's usually in these days where this hatred we have for other leaders or other individuals who might be leaders in other sects of Islam comes about. And we're not careful, we're very open in displaying that hatred, be it through a tweet or be it through a Facebook post or whatever the case may be, liking a tweet, reposting something, for example. Why? Because we have this emotional charge during Fatimiya. The poetry, the latmiya, the masa'ib, the musibah, all of that is geared towards the fact that after all, this was my mother. And it's no doubt, the musibah is azim. We should not take these days lightly. These days are grand for us. What happened to our mother is unheard of. But let's not use that emotion to divide the ummah. Let's not use that nation, that musibah to incite hatred, or to go against right now what is the norm or what is the call of the maraji. Let's be very careful. Instead, let's use that emotion to trigger this idea that not only do I want to grieve for my mother, I want to tread her path as well. Follow her path as well. emulate her path as well. And right now, there's no shortage of reasons to do that right now. If there was tension, if there was oppression, if there was chaos back then, that same chaos occurs today as well. And I get it. I get the fact that the emotion is real. The scars are very fresh. We have videos now being done. We have plays now being produced. We have poetry now being written. And those emotions get to the point where now all we see is this blind hatred. So I encourage all of you, these are not the days to debate takfiris. Not the days to try to convert people towards the musibat of Fatima. These are the days to cry for your mother. These are the days now to worry about the fact that what am I doing to give her her due respect? If others don't understand why we are gathering these numbers, then that's fine, they won't understand. That's okay. Sometimes what happens within your house should stay within your house. These are days, these are events that happen within our homes. We don't need to go out and try to propagate or try to convert or try to defend or try to debate those outside of our home. This is within our home. Let's grieve together. Let's console each other. Let's send each other condolences. And let's cry for Imam al-Zamana. At the same time, let's make a promise to Fatima Zahra that you didn't give your life in vain. If you defended wilayat back then, we defend that same wilayat today as well. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I wanted to make that point clear to all of you. Now let's move towards our actual content. And to understand a little bit of what topic I want to talk about, let me use the help of a verse of the Quran. And those of you who have smartphones, you can follow along with your Quranic apps. Surah Hajj, verse number 73. Surah Hajj. Verse 73 is a great place to start for what we want to accomplish in these next 3 nights. And I'll go through the ayats bit by bit, inshallah. Stay with me. We'll do our best to come to some conclusion tonight, inshallah. The verse starts off by addressing all of mankind. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind. You should know, and you do know, alhamdulillah, you have enough ulama that come through Dearborn to know. The Quran sometimes talks to a very specific group, and sometimes that Quran speaks to all of mankind. And each person that it addresses, the message reflects that individual. Meaning if it is a address towards all of mankind, Ya ayyuhan nas, Ya bani Adama, then usually the message applies to everybody across the board. If the message is for Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, those who are believers, that's a very specific message for the believers themselves. The others won't understand that message. But this verse starts off by saying, Ya ayyuhan nas, dhuriba mathlun fastami'u lah. Very interesting. This verse is very interesting in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses imagery and certain words to make his point across. He says, an example, a parable, a mithal has been set forward. So listen very carefully. Doesn't mention that it's Allah's example. Doesn't mention the fact that it's an example for who or for what. Doesn't say anything. It just says, dhuriba mathlun, an example has been said. Now who said the example? Who brought the example? That's all irrelevant. Why did he do that? Look, it's human nature, right? It's human nature sometimes. That if a speaker comes forward and he's about to deliver his speech or his sermon or his poem or whatever the case may be, before that individual even opens his mouth, half of all of you as listeners have already told yourself, I'm going to listen to this person or I'm not going to listen to this person. Like for example, when you saw me walking across the stage and you know I'm about to begin, half of you had said, okay, this guy is going to be useless for me for 45 minutes. Other people thought maybe this guy might have something to actually add. And so already now, you've already made up your mind before I've opened my mouth, let's say for example, whether or not you're going to listen or not. Allah realizes that my audience in this verse are not those who believe in me all the time. Allah realizes there are the mushrikeen within nas, there are the munafiqeen within nas, the kuffar within nas. There are people that if I say daraballahu masalan, that this mithal, this example was set by Allah, the moment they hear Allah, their ears turn off. So Allah says, forget all that. An example has been set. Doesn't matter who it is. فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Now, majority of you, mashallah, know Arabic. You know sama'a and istama'a. A little bit of Arabic grammar here. Are two different meanings. And specifically in the world of fiqh, for example, they use these terms to determine what the ruling is, sometimes for music. For example, a lot of you ask us, let's say I go to malls to shop. I go to the mall and I walk around the mall to shop, let's say. And in the malls they play music. Stores play music. Is it okay for me to go to those malls even though there's music being played? Is it okay for me to sit in a restaurant where music is being played? Or do I need to go to the mall manager and say, look, I'm only here for 45 minutes. Can you shut the music off in the entire mall? While I'm still inside shopping, the moment I turn it back on. And here the fiqh makes a very interesting decision between sama'a and istama'a. Sama'a means to hear something. Istama'a means to listen very carefully to it. And the fiqh says that so long as you are simply hearing the music and not listening to it, you're okay. Right? There are some of us who go through the mall and the music is being played and we don't even pay any attention. Then there are some of us who enter a store and our song is on. That's our song, man. That's our jam, right? And even though that store has nothing we want to shop for, we kind of make a couple of extra rounds around the stores while my jam is still going on. The moment my jam stops, I say, you know what? There's nothing for me here. Let's head out. That's called istama'a, listening very careful. That's problematic. The Quran here says, look, an example has been set forward. It says what? فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Listen very carefully. And then he says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. For those that you call upon, that are besides Allah, that are besides God, everybody who has a small g as a god that we call upon, look at the imagery Allah uses in this verse. Look at the imagery. Sometimes Allah uses rocks. Sometimes Allah uses animals. Sometimes Allah uses the sun and the moon. Why? He's trying to make sure that we, as limited individuals, understand a divine and unlimited concept. So he uses simple examples. In this verse, he uses a very simple example. He compares those that we call upon besides Allah as those individuals, what? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلِوَجْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Listen very carefully. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. No, this is a very beautiful crowd, mashallah, and all of you have the love of the Ahl al-Bayt. You can do a much better salawat than that, inshallah, please. Thank you. He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا ذُبَابًا وَلِوَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. For those of you that you call upon besides Allah, these concepts that are besides Allah, they can never even create a fly. They can't create a fly. Allah takes all of these small g gods that we call upon and brings them down to nothing and challenges them and says, forget the universe, forget the stars, forget the plants, forget the insan. Do me a favor and show me how you create a fly. A dhubab is a fly. That annoying, buzzing animal we try to swat all day long. That's the example Allah uses. And then he says to the point where even if all of these various small g gods come together in one room, put every money in, every power in, every education in, every skill in, they still are not able to come together to create a fly. And then he goes one step further and really steps up the challenge. He says, وَإِنْ يَسْلُبُهُمْ ذُبَابُ شَيْئًا لَا يَسْتَنْقِذُوهُمْ مِنْهُ. Oh my God, this is even amazing. He says, forget creating a fly. Because if that fly was to grab something from you, was to do salb from you, take something from you, you can't even bring that small thing that he took back from that fly. Look, we go to picnics, right, here in Dearborn, right? When the weather is nice and hot in the summertime, we gather the family, we pack up some food, we grab a football, let's say, for example, we go to the park, we lay out our sheets, we set up our food, right? We cut some watermelon, we have our sandwiches, everything is good to go. We're there, our family is there, our siblings are there, and the flies are there as well, right? Like an annoying relative during the holidays, they just come uninvited, unfortunately. They buzz around, and what do? They land on your food. Now, you have usually one individual, you say, look, your job is to swat the flies away all day. We'll go play football, you sit here and you swat the flies. Now, I want you to imagine a fly come, lands on your watermelon, and flies off. You can't see it, but what that fly has done is grab a small piece of watermelon and take it off. Allah says, those that you call upon that are not me, they're so weak, they can't forget creation of a fly, they can't bring that watermelon back from the fly. They can't bring that watermelon back from the fly. Try it one day, see what happens. Let me know how it goes. Catch that fly and then take that watermelon from that fly and put it back on the watermelon. Update me how that went, by the way, please, if you can. All those who are إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Follow me, please. All of those that you call upon besides Allah, we've put Allah aside, we've called upon ABC, whether that's a person, an ideology, a small god, ourselves, our nafs, whatever the case may be, everybody but Allah. All these people that you call upon, they don't have the power to take that watermelon back. Then he says, and he concludes the ayat, ذَعَفَ طَالِبُ وَمَطْلُوبُ. Not only is the one who seeks these gods weak, but the gods themselves are weak as well. The talib is weak, the matlub is weak. The seeker is weak, the sought after is also weak as well. Feel the pain of Allah in this verse. Why did Allah need to resort to this example? The next ayah 74, those of you who are following along, he then comes up with this statement. Some ulama have called it the tragedy of the human race. Allahu Akbar. مَا قَدْرَ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌ عَزِيزٌ. The reality is that you have not given Allah his due respect. You haven't given him his qadr. Qadr in Urdu, in Farsi, in Arabi mean the exact same thing. It's value, it's due respect. You've stripped that qadr from Allah. How? By calling on those gods besides Allah that really are powerless. We put all of our energy, all of our hope into these small g gods while Allah is sitting here and saying, look, what have I ever let you down? Tell me a moment where I've called upon you and where you've called upon me and I haven't answered you. Tell me a moment where you prayed for risk and I haven't given you that risk. Tell me a moment where you begged me for forgiveness, I haven't forgiven you. There's too many opportunities, too many realities for us to do what? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. And Allah says, look, you haven't given me my due respect. You haven't. I've done this for you, I've done that for you. I've done it to the point where it feels like God's the slave, and na'udhu billah, we are the master. Right? When we are ready, we call upon Allah, do we not? And we expect Him to come, fulfill our du'as within 24 hours. If He doesn't, you're out. Let's go to these guys. Right? He's the slave and we are the master. That's not tragic, it's tragic. Because the reality is, you take this verse and you look at the first opening verses of Surah Dahr, Surah Insan, you understand the reality of the human race, the insan himself, and you understand that we have no business. We have no business challenging Allah the way that we do. We have no business pushing Him to one side. We have no business telling Allah, Allah, in these trying times, travel bans, Islamophobia, Washington's new president, all these things are very difficult for us. People were begging me, don't go, don't cross the border, don't go to Dearborn for God's sake. And almost as if I was guilty of a crime, stay at home and do your tabligh. I was telling my brother on the way here, there are actually some people telling me, you know what, forget all of this, just go and go back to IBM in 9 to 5. These are not the days for us to leave Allah's kingdom. These aren't the days for us to leave Allah and then begin to إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Because the reality is that He has given us far too much. Look at Surah Insan. Let's try to establish a few things here. صَلُّوا عَلَى مُحَمَّدُ وَعَلَى مُحَمَّدُ. And these are a little bit, you know, this is a little bit difficult to digest, to swallow. And I don't mean to be Mr. Negative on the very first night. You guys won't be here tomorrow then. But the reality is a very simple one. Sometimes we need to be shaken at our core. When we examine the musibat of Fatima, the musibat of Fatimiya, and we often wonder, how is it possible? That, you know, fine, we can kind of understand how Ashura happened, maybe to some extent, right? Maybe we can understand how Shimr bin Dhul-Joshan could sit there and separate the head from Hussein's body. Maybe why 50 years had passed from the Prophet of Allah's death to the day of Ashura. 50 years is a long time. People forget. Shaitan comes and of course whispers. The dunya gets the best of them. But this musibah, a few months, you were just beside the Holy Prophet. You walked with the man, you talked with the man, you prayed behind the man, you ate with the man, you said labayk to the man. You saw him come to that very door you're about to burn and say, As-salamu alaykum ya ahl bayt al-nabuwa. You saw that very prophet that the entire universe bows down to come at that door and seek permission to enter that door. And that door now you have the gall to burn down? After a mere month of this man leaving the world, it goes to show you the insan has these dual qualities inside of us that's very, very dangerous. And the moment that we let our guard down, we could lose everything, my brothers and my sisters. These are people, of course, who saw the Holy Prophet. These are people who lived the Holy Prophet. These are people who, you know, were right beside him, and yet they still had the audacity to do what they did. It's mind-blowing. It's to the point where there are certain individuals within the Islamic world who deny the whole event. Who say, no, Fatima died peacefully in her sleep. There was no burning of the door. There was no crushing of her to the wall. All of that is all Shia makeup, nothing else. I don't know how many 18-year-olds died peacefully in their sleep. But khair. The reason why this discussion is so important for us to understand the connection between us and our Creator is because the moment that we begin to slip away from Allah, we could very well be those individuals who have the gall to be at the door of Fatima in a different way in today's day and age. Look at Surah Insan. It takes the insan and all of that insan's ghurur and takabur and ego and crushes it. It says, what hal ata al insani? حِينَ مِنْ دَهَ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. There was a time, let me remind you, the Quran says, there was a time where you, the insan, we, the insan, were nothing worth mentioning. The sun was created before you. The sun is worth mentioning, not you. The moon, the stars, the galaxies, they're all created before us. They're worth mentioning, we're not worth mentioning. Animal kingdom was created before us. They're worth mentioning, we're not worth mentioning. We were nothing. Allah then says what? Inna khalaqna al-insana min nutfatin amshajin. He says, then we created you out of this germ, this fluid, this nutfa. Reminds you where you came from, what you were. I was the one that brought you into existence. You know, some people who, they become philosophers sometimes, right? They become irfani, mashallah. They want to walk through walls and they want to be in Mashhad by noon, for example. Right? Sayyid, talk to us about Irfan, Sayyid. Give me a dhikr, Sayyid. And sometimes when you get a little bit, you know, too, you know, falsafi, as they call it, they start to question, did Allah ever ask me to be created? Right? I'm going through hell right now. I'm going through one test after one test after one test in this disgusting asfalasafaleen world. Was I ever approached? Was I ever asked by Allah? Was there a consultation? Was there a meeting? Was there a would you mind being created question? The Quran says, look, you are nothing, man. You weren't even something to be worth mentioning. And Allah did what? Allah gifted us with existence. And then on top of that, we have the gall to say, why did you create me? I didn't ask for all of this. In fact, the opposite makes sense, right? If he didn't create us, we could say to Allah, look, Allah, you're a khaliq. You're the best khaliq in this universe. You had every tool around you to create the insan, every reason to create the insan. If he didn't create us, then we could ask, why wouldn't you create me? Why wouldn't you give me existence? But no, we go the other way. Why? A little bit of this dunya shakes us at a core and we go back to Allah and say, Allah, you know what? I didn't ask for all this, by the way. Thank you very much for putting me in a miserable state in this dunya. And then on top of that, you'll say, you know what? I'm going to judge you on the day of judgment. Either eternal damnation or eternal, mashallah, success. Right? We become a little bit falsafi and say, you know, nobody asked me before creating me. Well, you were nothing. How could we create? How could we ask you? You were nothing. And then the next ayat, he says what? إِنَّ حَدَيْنَاهُ سَبِيلًا إِمَّا شَاكِرًا وَإِمَّا كَفُورًا. Fine, we created you. We also gave you all the tools for hidayat. We gave you everything to be successful. We gave you the sabir, we gave you the path of guidance. Now some of us will be shakir, thankful to Allah, wa imma kafura. And other people will do what? Kufran in ni'mat. It's your choice, no one's gonna force you in this world. But don't complain to Allah that Allah, you created me, you left me in this miserable state, and then you took off. No, he gave you everything you could possibly imagine. Thousands of prophets, 12 imams, parents of Quran, the ulama, your own aqal, marjiyat, all these things that are divine graces of Allah. For what? For hidayat, for guidance. Even shaitan will say to the someone like me complains to Allah, Allah, look, I'm in this state because shaitan whispered at me. It's shaitan, so grab him by the horns, don't grab me. Shaitan goes, whoa, 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 whoa. All I did was whisper at you, man. All I did was suggest a few things. All I did was maybe try this. I didn't grab your hand. I didn't force you. I don't have that kind of power. Quran's very open. Shaitan doesn't have that saltanat over you. Doesn't have that type of authority over you to grab you by the neck and kicking and screaming, I don't want to go, I don't want to go, and put you in that club or put you in that casino. Or put that drink in your hand. Shaitan goes, no, man. All I did was I whispered. I whispered, and 124,000 prophets whispered. I whispered, and 14 masumin whispered. I whispered, and every alim possible whispered. I whispered, and my mom and my dad whispered. I whispered, the Quran whispered. And you're going to ignore all of that and listen to little old me? And then on top of that, blame me for your situation? Allah says, look, I've given you too much. I've given you too much. The choice is yours. Even if we live our life, my brothers and my sisters, can you imagine for a moment? Even if we live our life the way we want, not the way Allah wants, even at the time of death, all of you who have been to funerals, in the cemetery, there's something called talqeen that's being read. Right? You've seen that, right? If you lost your father or somebody who is close to you, you're the one who's there holding the shoulders of that mayyat, and the alim reads talqeen. Have you listened to that talqeen? Have you read the translation? Isma ifham, fulan ibn fulan. Listen, understand, listen, understand. And then the entire talqeen are what are answers to the exam you're about to go through in the grave. That's it. You'll be asked, who's your Lord? What's your book? Where's your Qibla? Who's your Prophet? Who are your Imams? And oh, by the way, when you're asked that, just say this. Your Rabb is your Lord. Kaaba is your Qibla. The Quran is my book. Not once, twice. Once when everyone's there and people leave that cemetery and then it's only you as the mayyat and the alim says, just in case you forgot, because now you're in the grave, let me tell you again, when you're asked by the angels, this is what you should say. I mean, there's been an incredible system of guidance that's been laid down for us from the moment that Allah has created us to the moment that we leave this world. And still, we actually believe that we know a little bit more than God. We challenge Him like we are the master and He is the slave. Look at what Imam Ali says, alayhi salatu wassalam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And again, these are not made to bring anybody down. No, these are made for us to understand where we are and where Allah is. If we have any respect in this world, لَقَدْ كَرَمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ, the Quran says, we have honored the human race. If Allah asked every single existence to bow down to Adam, if we as a human race are the greatest creation of Allah, it has nothing to do with us as the makhluk and everything to do with our khaliq. We are great because we are associated with Him. He created us, so we, by association, become great. Now we, people like me, have taken that greatness, we've stripped Allah of that greatness, and we've fed our own souls. We pumped that ego, and now our head is in the clouds, our feet are 2 feet off the ground, and we're floating in this world. Look at what Imam Ali says, and all of you have heard this, mashallah. The human is that existence that starts off with a najis fluid and ends up as powder in the grave. His ibtida, his starting, is najasa. His ending also is najasa. A mayyat is najis. In between, what is he? He's a vessel for feces. Things go inside of us, things go outside of us. Input, output. That's what he says the insan is. And still he says, I wonder how, given this equation, the insan has the gall to do what? To say ana, and man, and ma, and me, and I. Allah says, whoa, now this is a bit too much for me. And I bring this up tonight, why? Because we live in an era of consumerism. And we live in the era of self-promotion. Because eventually we're going to lead towards the idea that in order for us to safeguard our iman in these trying times, In the rest specifically, we have to build certainty. We have to build insights. If your deen is a little bit rocky, then this era that we live in right now will destroy that base altogether. And we've seen it, so have you, I'm sure, all of you have seen. People change overnight. A little bit of a ban, a little bit of some executive orders from your president, he's not mine, from your president, and now all of a sudden now everything becomes a little bit out of control and out of whack. Don't go to Karbala for ziyarat, don't go to Hajj, let's say for example, sit at home, this and that, let's be very careful now. Let's be very careful. These are trying times for us. Unless and until we have this solid base, it's going to be a problem. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, he says what? He says, for those of you who enter the religion, listen very carefully, enter the deen, enter the, become spiritual, because of people, you'll exit the deen because of people. But if you enter the deen based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Ahlul Bayts, mountains will move, he says, but you won't leave the deen. So the choice really is yours. It's ours. Imam Ali, now he's prepping his soldiers to go to battle. He would often give them some spiritual advice, and he would tell them, look, your iman, your faith inside of you has two forms. Either it's a flag or it's a mountain. What do flags do? Flags blow as the wind blows them. If the wind goes east, the flag goes east. If the wind goes west, the flag goes west. In fact, certain people actually measure the wind based on where the flag is blowing. The flag itself has no identity. The flag is simply a representation of where the wind is taking it. You've seen people, right? One day, mashallah, they are this way. Next day, astaghfirullah, they are this way. The wind of kufr takes them east. The wind of iman takes them west, for example. He said, or you can be a mountain. The wind can be as strong as it wants to be. Left, right, east, west. You don't move from where you are. That choice is yours, and that choice, if you ask me, is no bigger than it is now. If you think there isn't work being done in your iman, it is. It's a very slow release right now, chipping away at the base. And one day you'll wake up and you'll start to do what? Start to question God, question Salat, question the Imams, question the day after the day of judgment. And now what was once this fear now, that maybe our kids might not pray Salat, or fast, or do azadari, or give khums. Now the fear is what? Maybe our kids might be atheists when they grow up. Maybe our kids might be agnostic when they grow up. You know, we have these Islamic experts on CNN. It's a joke, right? You listen to these people who give their reports on CNN or Fox News, or and you think, wow, this guy has no idea what he's talking about. Rest assured, in 15, 20 years, there'll be 40 people like that who are ready to go on CNN and present their analysis of the deen if we don't get our acts straight. If we don't build that certainty. The majority of you were born into Muslim families. You had the pleasure and the honor and the convenience of knowing the deen from day number one. A lot of you are skeptical about some of the very basic tenets of this deen. And skepticism is the first step to certainty. I have no problem with skepticism. In fact, I honor this millennial generation for the fact that they ask questions that our parents and their elders never had the himmah to ask and the gall to ask. But those doubts that you have right now, there are people in this room who can't prove God. There are people in this room who pray salat through motions. There are people right now who fast in a month of Ramadan as a hunger strike. Why? Because that base isn't there yet. And that base requires work. I have no problem with you doubting. I have no problem with us being skeptical. What I do have a problem with is us not going to the right source to answer those doubts, allowing those doubts to fester, to build, and eventually to overtake your iman. We have people denouncing their religion publicly on Facebook nowadays, saying, I from today am no longer a Muslim for this reason. And then on top of that, you have these mashallah amazing Muslims who are commenting, saying, wow, you are an inspiration for us. Look at the freedom you have to express yourself. Almost as if Islam has chained them and muzzled them. So look, you can't say a single word. She now, he now, wow, they're free now. They can go, they can do whatever they want. And now there's this envious nature. This is coming now, guys. It's coming. If we don't get our act straight. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So in this initial discussion tonight, I wanted to establish the idea of us and Allah. The pain of Allah, the tragedy of the human being. The fact that we have resorted to everybody but Allah. And don't think that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ are for the mushrikeen. Back then they used to worship idols. There's idol worshiping happening today as well. And the biggest idol we have sometimes is ourselves. Right? We live in a self-marketing era. We live in the selfie era. Where now you are no longer a person, you're a brand on social media. There are people in this world today that are getting paid thousands and millions for what? For being them. For showing up at a party, for attending, let's say, a gala event. They have no skill, they have nothing to offer society, but they are them. Why? We live in that branding era. This past Arba'een, I was talking to a friend of mine who made this walk from Najaf to Karbala. We're talking about the amazing spiritual atmosphere. You have to go, Sayyid. It's one thing you have to experience. And then he says to me, can you imagine for a moment what was the hottest selling item in the streets of Karbala and the stores of Karbala? Now I thought for a moment, maybe a kafan, maybe a tasbih, maybe a mohr. But no, he said the hardest selling item was a selfie stick. Was a selfie stick. That people would fight to the body of Imam Hussein, elbow and kick and get there somehow, and then turn around and get a nice selfie with Imam Hussein. I have nothing wrong with that. And they're saying that we are now, we're promoting this idea. Right? So we're selfies now, attached to the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, I want you to do what? I want you to submit to me, not submit to your own urges to propagate yourself on social media. Let's be very careful, inshallah. Because the reality is that we don't have our imam with us. These individuals who did this heinous act, like I said, weeks ago, months ago, before this act, were with the Holy Prophet. So we have to be a little bit more careful, the fact that our imam is not accessible to us. Because the reality is that the musibah and the sacrifice that has been made for us to have the deen that we belong to now, that sacrifice is far too big for us to ignore it. Too many lives have been killed, too much oppression has been done, too many mazlooms have gone through what they've gone through for us to have the deen we have today. And there's no bigger mazloom, they say, in that era than Amir al-Mu'mineen. There's a group in Medina, a group of men who are having a debate one time. And they're discussing this idea that what is the most difficult test for any man to go through. And at that moment, coincidentally, Imam Ali was passing by them. They call Imam Ali and they say, can you solve this question for us? Give us your take. What is the most difficult test for any man to go through? He thinks for a moment, he pauses for a moment, and he says the most difficult test for any man to go through is to have his wife unconscious on the ground and him being dragged to the masjid And he's asked to be patient. You know, usually when a husband loses his wife, the community comes forward and says, look, in terms of ghusl, in terms of burial, you don't need to do all that. We'll do it for you. But Imam Ali was that husband, that mazlum husband, who washed the body of his wife, who wrapped her in a kafan, and who buried her in the middle of the night. To the point where Asma bint Umais, who was in that room washing the body of Sayyidah Fatima, and outside that room, the sound of the crying of the family of Fatima could be heard. Ali says to Asma, Asma, go outside and quiet the children down. The neighbors have been complaining that ever since the Prophet left, your family's been crying day in and day out. Asma leaves this room, goes to the children and says, quiet down. But she says, the moment that I left that room, from inside that room where the ghusl was being done, I could hear the loudest of shrieks. I went running in. I said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, if somebody was to ask me who was the bravest of them all, the one from Khaybar, the one from Khandaq, the one from Badr, I would say it was you, Mawla. But this shriek, this cry, this lament, what happened? He said, Asma, what do I tell you? I had no idea. I'm doing the ghusl of Fatima. But I had no idea that her ribs were completely broken. I had no idea the pain that my Fatima went through. The same Ali who was told in her will that Ali, I want you to give me ghusl. Ali, I want you to give me kafan. Ali, I want you to bury me in the middle of the night. I don't want these people inside my burial. Imam Ali takes the janazah and the mayat of his wife to the cemetery, buries that body inside the cemetery. There comes a moment in the morning when the people of Medina find out that in the middle of the night while they were sleeping, the daughter of Muhammad was buried. They had no chance for salat, no chance for condolences. They go to Ali, they approach the grave, and one man has the courage to say, Ali, we will redig the grave of Fatima. We will take her out of her grave. We will pray salat. We will give her right. It's at that moment that Ali pulls out his zulfiqar and says, if any of you comes near the grave of my Fatima, I'll make you a part of the dirt that you stand on. I'll say this much to you, Ali. The sheer suggestion that somebody might disrespect the body of your wife caused you to pull the zulfiqar out. Come to Karbala, Mawla. There was no possibility there. There were no suggestions there. Umar ibn Sa'd says what? After Asr al-Ashur, I want 10 horses to go change the hooves on their horses. The body of Hussein lies on the plains of Karbala. I want those 10 horses to trample the body of Hussein. Where were you, Ali, at that moment when somebody suggested the body of Fatima comes out? If only your Zulfiqar, Ali, was there, maybe our Aqa Hussein's body wouldn't be trampled. سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. We ask you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to accept this qaleel ibad, inshallah. We ask you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to forgive our sins and those of our parents. We ask you, Allah, our final dua is that in this lifetime allow us to witness the zuhur of Imam Zamana, inshallah, and allow us to be his ansar when he comes. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.